Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. A light bulb joke is a joke about how many people in a certain group does it take to change a light bulb or to screw one in or replace it or whatever. For example, how many psychiatrists does it take to change a light bulb? One, but the light bulb really has to want to change. Or how many computer programmers does it take to change a light bulb? None. That's a hardware problem. Or how many government bureaucrats does it take to change a light bulb? Two. One, to reassure the public that everything possible is being done to fix the problem, and another one to take the light bulb and screw it into the water faucet. And finally, how many Lutherans does it take to change a light bulb? Five, one to change the light bulb, and four to stand around looking up saying, you know, I think I like the old light bulb better. I have in my hand a three-way light bulb. The three-way light bulb was the first attempt at mood lighting. One light bulb that could be switched to three different levels of intensity, casting a completely different light across the room. Want to read? Crank it up to 150 watts. Just talking? Take it down to 100 watts. Want to snuggle with your sweetie? Take it down to 50 watts. One light bulb that can be experienced in three different ways depending on the light that is produced. Sort of like the Trinity. This day we celebrate the Holy Trinity on this Holy Trinity Sunday. We join Christians around the world in reflecting on one of the greatest doctrines of the church, the magnificent mystery of divinity, three in one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But if you know much about church history, then you know that the Trinity is one of the thorniest and trickiest subjects in all of church history. And so while we may sing about, talk about, and even praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the nature of the Trinity for most of us is not part of our daily expression of faith. And yet, it ought to be, because it's this kind of faith, hope, and love that the world is hungering for. It's experiencing God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that keeps our faith fresh and allows for Christ to be reborn into the world each and every day. Ella Fitzgerald made a song famous back in 1947 called A Sunday Kind of Love. It's the same song that made Christina Aguilera famous as a little girl when she sung it on a TV show in the 1980s. This song speaks to every generation because every generation is looking for a different kind of love than what they find in culture. They're not looking for a Monday kind of love or a Tuesday kind of love or a Wednesday kind of love or a Thursday kind of love or a Friday kind of love or a Saturday kind of love, but a Sunday kind of love. The first two stanzas of the song goes like this. I want a Sunday kind of love, a love to last past Saturday night. I'd like to know it's more than love at first sight. I want a Sunday kind of love. I want a love that's on the square. Can't seem to find somebody to care. I'm on a lonely road that leads me nowhere. I need a Sunday kind of love. So what makes a Sunday kind of love so special, so desirous, so longed for? Well, it's a kind of love that you find in church on Sunday morning. It's a kind of love you hear preached about in churches on Sunday morning. It's a Trinity love, such as we celebrate this day. It's a sacramental love, such as we remember on this Memorial Day weekend, as we give thanks for those who have given their lives for the sake of love and freedom. A Sunday kind of love is a love triangle. Not a bad kind of love triangle that triangulates people and pits them against one another. No, a Sunday kind of love is a Trinity love. As we experience a three-in-one lifestyle, a Sunday kind of love is a three-way light bulb kind of love. It's a love that comes from experiencing God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. A complete three-in-one, one-in-three experience. St. Augustine used to refer to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit as the lover, the loved, and the love between the lover and the loved. In that sense, God the Father is the lover, the expresser of love. Jesus, the Son, is the loved, the one who experiences love. And the Holy Trinity is the love between them. Together they make for this amazing unity of love. Together they make for this amazing relationship. For centuries, sailors used to navigate their way across the ocean using a practice called triangulation. To triangulate one's way across the ocean was to measure the angle of a triangle that was based upon the observer in relationship to two known locations. Together, the three points allowed for the sailor to navigate across even unknown waters, confident that he or she were heading in the right direction. In the same way, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit gives us all we need to navigate across the course of our lives. Here, this God, lover, loved, and love is defined by relationship and is known by being in relationship to the world. And furthermore, we who are the body of Christ are called to be a part of this relationship. We're called to navigate our lives by reflecting the lover, the loved, and the love, to enter in to this life of this God who is love. In Romans, our lesson for today, St. Paul says this, "And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us." God's love has been poured into our hearts. This is huge. God invites us into the triune life of God. God invites us into the love triangle. God invites us to participate in this relationship that unifies Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is why the body of Christ exists. This is why you and I are here, to be a part of the love triangle and to offer the world a Sunday kind of love. You know, Jesus was the greatest lover the world has ever known. It was love that brought him into this world. It was love that took him to the cross. It was love that took him to hell and back, back to earth and back to heaven. And yet Jesus is also referred to in scriptures as the beloved. God says, "You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased." And we're also told that God the lover so loved the world that he gave his only beloved, his only begotten Son. But the truth is, this love that's so perfectly expressed in the Trinity is not so perfectly expressed in the people of the Trinity. I like the story of the church that, for its Lenten theme, decided to use as its theme the hard sayings of Jesus. Each week, one of these difficult sayings of Jesus was explored and explained, teaching such as, "Turn the other cheek, love your enemy, walk the second mile, pray for those who persecute you." One young student said, "You know, these teachings of Jesus are so hard because I don't understand them." And an older person said, "For me, it's just the opposite. These teachings are so hard because I do understand them. It's just I'm not sure I want to do them." It's not always easy expressing an aspect of the holy love triangle. It's not always easy being the lover, for example, because some people are hard to love. And for some of us, it's hard to be the loved, the one who receives love. And sometimes it's just difficult being the love that makes a difference. But it's only by reflecting these different personas of the lover, the loved, and the love, that the body of Christ continues to be a vital, living, transforming force for the world. Indeed, the only hope for the world. Once there was a high school student who was badly burned in an automobile accident. For a while, it was touch and go as to whether he would live or not. The boy's high school English teacher didn't know how badly burned he was, but she was concerned that he might fall behind in his studies. And so she arranged for a tutor to go to the hospital to work with the boy on what the class was studying: irregular verbs and dangling participles. When the English teacher finally went to the hospital to visit the boy, she was horrified. She found him still in the critical care unit. He was mummified, completely wrapped in white gauze. The only part of his body he could move was his mouth, and just barely. The teacher couldn't believe she had been so insensitive as to send this boy, a tutor, to teach him irregular verbs and dangling participles. But as she was leaving, the head nurse said to her, "You saved that boy's life. You did a miracle with that boy. You know that, right?" And the teacher tried to explain and said, "I'm so embarrassed. I can't believe I sent that boy a tutor. I don't know what I was thinking." "No," said the nurse, "you saved the boy's life. When the boy first came here, he was depressed. He was unresponsive. He just laid there. He had given up. He was waiting to die. But then the tutor came, and the boy's whole attitude changed. He started to talk. He started to respond to treatment. And now he's turned the corner, and we believe he's going to make it." The teacher still wasn't quite sure what this nurse was saying. But later, the boy himself, when he got out of the hospital, explained the difference the tutor made to his teacher. The boy said this: "At first, they told me I would live, and I did not believe them. I thought they were just trying to tell me something like that because they didn't want to tell me the truth that I was going to die. But when that tutor came, I knew differently because I knew they would never send a tutor to a dying boy to teach him irregular verbs and dangling participles." The world needs to know it can live. The world needs to know there's hope for its future. Love is an action. Love is a verb. Triangulate the love. Share the love triangle. Share a Sunday kind of love. Because in truth, it's the brightest and best love there is. So let it shine. Amen.